Now with us in the studio is Beau Baconguis, Country Program Manager of Greenpeace Southeast Asia. Beau, good evening and thanks for joining us tonight.
Good evening.
All right, let's go back to the original concern here, because now they're saying it's wastewater, it's organic, shouldn't be a problem. Mm-hmm. But is Greenpeace sold on that?
Well, if it's organic pollution, it shouldn't be a problem if it's treated before it's dumped. However, there's a concern from us that there is a possibility that there are hazardous chemicals even in the organic waste that they are disposing into the oceans.
But how will we know?
We don't know, because it is not part of the normal processes for testing. Unless you're looking for very specific chemicals, then you won't find it.
Mm. But in an area like the Subic Bay, and you know it's a point where all these ships go, should it be part of the protocols?
Yes, but in fact we're asking DENR to expand the coverage of the parameters that they measure, because right now it's very limited to a very few, like heavy metals, very few hazardous chemicals. They look for the normal tests would only include like biological oxygen demands, settleable solids, all these very basic tests. But now that we know that every single day we're dumping thousands and thousands of chemicals, we should be trying to expand our standards to include many of these hazardous chemicals that we don't normally test at this point.
Mm. Beau, this incident that supposedly took place in the Subic Bay area has left people wondering whether or not the government or the authorities do have the proper monitoring system or mechanism in place, because we got a lot of conflicting feedback from the authorities, right? You got the SBMA mm-hmm. saying, all right, that's not confirmed dumping, it's mm-hmm. alleged dumping. Mm-hmm. And then later on saying, okay, the hazardous waste is not hazardous at all.
I mean,
it's organic, because there may be some toxicity levels that are elevated mm-hmm. from before, but mm-hmm. not to the point that they're dangerous to people. And we don't know whether or not the VFA covers the dumping of waste into Subic Bay. I mean, all of these things taken together, does that paint you a picture that we don't really have a clear-cut mechanism on how to deal with incidents like these?
Yes, we see this as a problem, because even monitoring of hazardous materials, hazardous chemicals, is very weak in government right mm. now. Like if we look, we have laws that supposedly address the problems of hazardous waste dumping. You have RA 6969, and under the law, a government is supposed to come up with a list of chemicals that they should be looking at and starting to come up with elimination program for that.
Okay.
However, right now we only have more than 20 years since the law was passed. We only have 5 chemicals that are under chemical control orders.
Mm-hmm.
So that's how bad we are in terms of looking at the pollution issues.
So the law is there, but the implementing guidelines or even the mechanism to implement the law does not exist fully.
Yes, and the capacity of our personnel to do monitoring mm. At a regular basis is severely lacking.
Mm-hmm. Mm. Is what they have right now completely transparent? Because in the press conference a while ago, you heard SBMA Chairman Roberto Garcia saying that he stands by the integrity of their tests. Mm-hmm. It was witnessed by a team of people, and he stands by that. But is it transparent? Were all the stakeholders there? Do you think that the transparency was there in the system that they have, in the SBMA at least?
Well, I personally, I think that there was not enough transparency in place, because if there were, then all the other stakeholders would have access to that information, and they would be able to determine what the problem areas are in the testing. Mm-hmm. So maybe that's lacking, I'm not sure. I cannot say, because I also did not have access to that information, especially the documents that say the reports that they came up with. The public does not have that access to that information. And that is one issue that we wanted also to raise. It's not only an issue of this dumping, but something that could happen in the future. And that is why Greenpeace is actually pushing forward a campaign on pollution disclosure, which our government systems do not have yet, but in other countries they are already in place. For in the US it has been in place for more than 20 years already, and we're lagging behind in terms of pollution transparency, because that actually helps get the public involved in pollution monitoring.
Because you don't want to be caught in a situation, Tony, wherein an incident already happened and we were caught flat-footed and we don't know what to do anymore because of the lack of monitoring or the lack of transparency that was involved, that was supposed to be involved to begin with.
Well, there are many agencies, obviously, that monitor environmental protection. Now, I don't know, like in the States, they have an EPA, so the Environmental Protection Agency, so it's really a centralized bureau or bureaucracy that makes sure that all the environmental laws are implemented. Pero dito sa atin, medyo watak-watak pa. I mean, you know, you know, one bureau takes care of this and one bureau takes care of that. And obviously, I just got some information now that the DENR does not have any jurisdiction about marine pollution. It's the Coast Guard.
It's the Coast Guard.
So Coast Guard lang, no? Dapat sila. So when it comes to, say, like Subic, Coast Guard lang dapat ang unang takbuhan mo. I mean, they're the ones who have to give approval whether or not waste is all right to be discharged into the water. Diba? It has to be treated first.
Right.
But do we have sufficient treatment facilities ba for hazardous materials?
Well, for hazardous materials, I don't think we have sufficient good quality laboratories that could test, and treatment facilities. Actually, when you look at especially when you're dealing with hazardous chemicals, you have to look at the different characters of each chemical before you're able to treat it. So you don't just dump it into one facility and then treat it because some of the hazardous chemicals can escape into the environment even after treatment. And we know that sometimes some companies try to, you know, just to be able to save on costs, they will not run their wastewater treatment facilities up to standards, or sometimes they don't run it at all, only when they know that somebody is coming to
check.
So many times you will still find toxic spills, you know, chemical accidents, because we are not vigilant enough.
And shortcuts are always being taken.
Yes.
Have you done any study with regard to Subic Bay itself?
No, not Subic Bay. But we've done a lot of investigations in terms of water quality, testing for pollution from different sources of water, especially industrial pollution areas. So, and we've seen that many of the, even if DENR says, okay, this company is in compliance, but in our tests we find that there are chemicals that the DNR does not test, or the LLDA does not test, which we have found. So some of the most hazardous chemicals right now, like, for example, the anti-fouling agent, yung tributyl tin, is not yet being, it's used to paint the ship so that the barnacles won't stick to it. So these are chemicals that are still being used. And we don't have a chemical control order yet for that kind of chemical. And there are also other, many other hazardous chemicals used in industry right now that are not yet under control. So
And you're using not Greenpeace standards here, but international standards.
Yes, we're looking at international standards, but we use Greenpeace laboratories in doing the tests, based at the University of Exeter. So what we do is do a scan of all the chemicals that we can possibly look for.
For example, the Glen Defense Marine tanker that is involved here, Chairman Roberto Garcia did say that the samples that were taken were not taken from the sea, they were taken from the sample itself. And again, vouched for the integrity of the process. But then, do we just take their word for it? Because some people are still thinking twice about that.
Yeah, well, I would like to know what is the process that the tests underwent. What did it undergo? Because we'd like to see what kind of parameters they used in testing. If they did, because in some of the reports I read that they actually did not test for some of the hazardous chemicals. So they only did BODs or CODs. You know, these are very basic tests that even college students will do, or high school students can do. But some of the more hazardous chemicals, if the reports are correct, we're not done.
Okay. Now, Beau, we have to wrap up, but I'm pretty sure there will be many more U.S. military ships that will be docking in Philippine waters, maybe not just in Subic Bay. I mean, of course, they also dock out there in Manila Bay, and many of them will probably have to discharge waste at one point, right? Do you see this incident now in the Subic Bay area giving rise to more stringent measures and even more alertness from our authorities as to how these things should be handled or processed?
Yes, I hope so. I hope that this is the wake-up call that we need. Mm-hmm. Because with hazardous chemicals, you know, you get more and more problem. So we need more people to be aware, the government agencies to be more vigilant, and communities to help in the monitoring, because we need them to. We know that we don't have enough personnel to be able to do the monitoring on a regular basis. So the communities can help, and transparency is important. We know that that will help the public be involved in pollution monitoring.
All right, Beau Baconguis, thank you very much for coming over to Prime Time and sharing with us, of course, some of the knowledge that Greenpeace has accumulated over the many decades that it has been around. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And coming up,